Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, I pray that as I come and deliver your word this morning, Lord Jesus, I pray that hope and faith will rise up, Lord. Father, I don't know the condition of the hearts of the many of people that are here, but Father, you do. And I pray, oh God, that this word, oh God, will resonate hope, future, not disaster, and peace and prosperity. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may take your seats. Come round. It's good to see you all, good-looking people. Yeah. I had a great first service. Thank you, band. Always do a good job. Singers, Jason. So good. This morning I want to speak to you, make the best of it. You know, there's a man from South Africa who lived in South Africa and was going on a fishing trip. So he drives his BMW to the jungle, parks it in the jungle, just near the jungle, but parks it there, and he goes, gets his stuff and goes on his fishing trip. He gets a great catch. It's a good day for this South African man. He comes back to the car and he is horrified to see his car is destroyed. The wipers are broken. There's baboons jumping on it. They've kicked in the headlights. They've broken the side lights and he's not happy. Eventually goes home and he devises a plan. I am going to get even. I'm going to get them back. So his next trip, obviously the BMW's a write-off. So he brings his Mercedes-Benz with all his fishing gear and he's devised a really clever plan. Parks his Mercedes-Benz, throws a whole lot of rubber snakes all over his car, just covered with rubber snakes, walks away and goes, okay, I've got them. Because, you know, primates are scared of snakes. So he thinks his Mercedes-Benz safe. Then he goes and walks through the jungle and goes and does his fishing trip and he gets a great catch. He comes back only to find these baboons with big boulder stones throwing them at his car. And his car is demolished because they were trying to kill the snakes with stones. That went well. Sometimes the solutions that we employ to our problems only make them worse. And we see through the scripture, we see throughout the word of God, throughout the scripture, so many times where the children of God, the people of God took shortcuts. I know better than God, I'm going to do it this way. I don't need to do it that way. I can do it this way. And so many times it brought pain and it brought trouble into their lives. And so today I want to speak on a passage of scripture that we all know. We've memorized it. We've used it in cards when we don't know what to say to the person. We've quoted the scripture. My daughter Rachel's doing year 12. She received the scripture this week from a teacher, beautiful teacher wrote this scripture. We quoted it when things are really bad and we just go, we've quoted the scripture. We've quoted the scripture when we just feel like we need a word from the Lord and we just need to hold on to something, which is good. But this morning I want to read the scripture and I want to bring it to light in its actual context because I've always, it's one of my favorite scriptures. In Bible Gateway, it's the second most quoted scriptures in the world. 100 most quoted scriptures in the world. Number one is John 3:16, and number two is this one. Some of you are going, I've worked it out. Jen has. Jess has. But I want to tell you, we have actually misquoted it. It's made us feel good. But I want to show you in the context that it's actually coming out of. And when you see it, it's actually going to bring a lot more encouragement. And when you use it, you're going to go, oh, I'm taking that one out. Because it's actually not just a throwaway scripture. it's actually in its context. Oh, it's hopeful. It's beautiful. And that is Jeremiah 29, 11 and 12. We're going to read the scripture 29, 11 to 14. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. And then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will hear you. You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with all your heart. You will be found, I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and gather you from all the nations and all the places where I have driven you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I sent you into exile. I want to put this scripture in its context. We see this is a book of Jeremiah 29. And the whole book of Jeremiah talks about Jeremiah was the prophet of God of the time. And he shares this scripture with a group of people that are in exile, that are in a place that they don't want to be. I want to share a little bit of the history of how they got here. So we see that in the year 597 BC, God is judging the nation of Judah because of their unfaithfulness and their rebelliousness. Now, you're probably thinking, gee, that's really harsh. That's a hard God. But I'm going to show you all the things that God actually did for them, and then you're going to go, they're dumb. They never got it. And so we see here that the Babylonians have attacked Jerusalem, and they've taken over, 10,000 prisoners with them to exile, to Babylon, to live in exile. And they've taken the king, and his name is Jehoiachin, and the queen's mother, the court officials, and some very craftsmen people that obviously was useful to them. So the Jews are going, this is not supposed to happen to us. We are God's chosen people. We are the golden favorites. We are the one and only. We are the apple of his eye. You can't be doing that to us. So they're in this place where they're prisoners in a land that they don't want to be, in a place they've never imagined they would be. But what I want you to see in a moment is that God always intervened in their lives, all the time. And this is on their resume, this is what would have been written. In their journeys, they would have written all the things that God did for them. And let's look at it. The history of God's people. It happened when Moses led them out of Egypt. It happened when God sustained them for 40 years in the wilderness. A journey that should only be 4 days took them 40 years because of rebellion. It happened when they were crossing the River Jordan. God was there. It happened when the walls of Jericho came tumbling down. It happened when they conquered the Promised Land. It happened when Gideon defeated the Midianites. It happened when Elijah defeated the prophets of Baal. It happened when David defeated Goliath. It happened when Jehoshaphat defeated the Ammonites. And if you don't get it now, like, I mean, we've got it. We're like, these people, they've been like rescued so many times. But if you don't get it now, like, this is what happened. On the sixth year, God would always give them a bumper crop. So they would have a year's worth of produce so they could actually take the whole year, the seventh year off. That's got me straight away. I'm like eating for days and not having to work a day in my life. I mean, I'm in. And so you would see this resume, you see the things that God has done for them, and yet they still don't get it. Over and over again, God intervened. Over and over again, God turned up. When he didn't have to, but he loved them, and he did. They had many privileges, and they enjoyed them all. But they continually ignored and disobeyed God and his warnings. Now they're in exile. They're in a place they don't want to be because of their own rebelliousness. False prophets will come to them, give them false hope and say, in 2 weeks, 2 weeks, just hold on for 2 weeks, you'll be out of here. But they were false prophets. Jeremiah, the prophet, comes with the word of the Lord. And we're going to read it and see what he is saying to the people. Jeremiah chapter 29, verses 1 to 6. And he writes this letter while they're in a place they don't want to be, in exile. This is a text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the surviving elders amongst the exile and to the priests, the prophets, and all the other people. I said to someone before, if I say this word wrong the first time, I'm going to say it wrong the whole time. Nebuchadnezzar, thank you, you've rescued me. Nebuchadnezzar had carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jehoiachin and the queen mother and the court officials and the leaders of Judah and Jerusalem, the skilled workers and the artisans had gone into exile from Jerusalem. Verse 3, he trusted the letter to Elasar, son of Shaphan, and I'm glad we've got easy names these days, Gemara, son of Hikai, whom Zedekiah, king of Judah, sent to King Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon and said, verse 4, this is what the Lord, my first language is Italian. It's easier in Italian. It's Nebi. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. So they're in a place in exile. And he says, build houses and settle down. I like that. Eat. I like that even more. The produce. Marry. Have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage. So they too will have sons and daughters and increase in the number. There do not decrease. I call this Jeremiah 29 the letter of keep calm and carry on. Could have called it that today, but I've called it make the best of it. Because pretty much that's what Jeremiah is saying. Turn your lemons into lemonade. Number one, we see bloom where you are planted. Basically, that's what he's saying. Hey guys, I know you don't like it. You're here because it's your fault. You continually disobey. You don't like it. So bloom. Plant. Get married. Have children. Have more children. Have grandchildren. Have great-grandchildren. Eat. Eat as much as you like. But plant and bloom. Replace your smoke alarms. Don't think you're getting out here soon. Place the smoke alarms every year. Renew your donkey's registration. Don't go without the donkey register. So you're getting the point? He's saying you're here for a while, so make the most of it. Bloom, plant, produce, enjoy. Have you ever found yourself in such a hard place? The very thing that you have wanted to do is lie down and hope that you die, or hope that it just goes away, or hope that things totally dramatically change in a second. And we all find ourselves when we have a bad report or a marriage fails or something drastic happens and we just, I want out. I just don't want to live. I don't want to move on. I don't want to function and survive. We get into spirals where getting out of bed sometimes can be hard. But he's saying to the people here, I know you hate it. I know you hate where you are, but bloom where you're planted. Secondly, we see Jeremiah tells them, got three P's here for those taking notes, to pardon, to forgive, to pray, and to prosper. To pardon, to pray, and to prosper. When all else fails, pray. Praise. When things come against you that are not your fault, someone offends you, someone hurts you, something happens, forgive. Even if it's not your fault, forgive them. It releases you. He unlocks things on you. Jeremiah verse 7 says, seek the peace, which is forgiveness, the pardon. Seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Isn't that great? You too will prosper. The Jews would have been thinking, you're what? Telling us to pray for them who've done bad things to us, who've brought us here to die, to suffer? And he's saying, yeah, pray, forgive them, hoping that God will rescue them like he did before. But he's like, no, praise, pray, prosper, pardon. How can we pray for these people? You know, I often see when someone has been done wrong by, and I watch their lives and I watch their response, and I've seen that those who've chosen to forgive and live in forgiveness are way further down the journey than those who talk about it over and over again. How could they? How dare they? How they should know better? Live in an isolated place, and pretty much you'll avoid them because you know what's going to come out. And they actually begin to age. They actually begin to look a little bit unattractive because their disposition is hate. They come out of malice. They're trying to get back. Encourage you, if someone does wrong by you, forgive them. You'll look different. You'll sound different. Number three, Jeremiah tells them to trust in God's word and his promise. Trust in God's word and his promise. Many times when I've been in a place that I've never wanted to be, but something has happened because life happens to us, whether it's sickness, whether it's a broken relationship, whatever it may be, I go to God and I say, God, I need a promise. I need a word. And I just like literally wait for God to give me something. And that's what I hold onto for dear life. Because when I don't know what's happening and it's getting worse, I say, but God, you said this to me, and I'm holding on to your word and your promise, because we know his word and his promises come to bear. Verse 10 says, this is what the Lord says. When 70 years, yes, I said it, 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. They're going, what? 70 years? Did you say 70 years? Last time it was only 40 days. You've brought it up to 70 years. So they're in a place like, this is not going to go away tomorrow, like the false prophet said. This is, we've got to live here for 70 years. Where some of us are going to die here. They're not happy. But I found that in the darkest places in our life, when we trust God, the best work begins to happen in our lives. We change. And when we change, those around us change. I remember in primary school, can't remember what grade it was, but I remember that we were taken on an excursion to the Coca-Cola factory. I was really excited because at the end of an excursion, you always get the goodies. So I was excited because I was going to get a bottle of Coca-Cola. But I actually really remember this excursion that when we went there, the man said to us, do not, whatever you do, don't touch the bottles. And I'm thinking, oh, yeah, that'd be really hot. Because back then, it wasn't aluminium or plastic. It was actually glass. Who remembers the old green glass bottles? Please raise your hands. The first service made me feel really old. But more hands. Just fake it. No. And so they had the old green bottles. And so he said, whatever you do, don't touch the bottles. And so every kid said, don't touch. You just want to touch, right? But no one did. They respected that rule. And the reason was that they would put them onto the conveyor belt, but they had to go through a process first. The manufacturers had a process what this Coke bottle was going to become. They had a dream for this Coke bottle. They had an appointed time and an end and a future for this bottle. And so the bottle, they'd get molten glass. They would heat it to its highest temperature. Then they would put it in the mold of the Coca-Cola bottle, and they'll put it into this mold, and then they would put it on the conveyor belt and let it cool down, and then it would pass through the conveyor belt into this hottest furnace that you could ever imagine, oven that you could ever imagine, and in there was the process was taking place. And I remember like him experimenting or showing us, he says, if it doesn't go through this process, if it doesn't actually go through the fire, this is what happens. And he gets a Coke bottle on the conveyor belt and he just tips two over and they literally shatter and they literally in pieces everywhere. He goes, we know the end product is to be to put a Coke bottle in the hand of every person in over the world, that they can have a refreshing drink. A refreshing Coke drink. And back then, I liked this concept, that you could get this green bottle, this Coke bottle that was filled with Coke, and when you finish drinking your Coke bottle, you could go to a store and you can give them your Coke bottle and they give you a few cents back, and then they don't fill it up for you, but you get your few cents back. And then they sterilize it and reuse it again. No rubbish, no clogging our garbage ways. And then they fill them up again. Unfortunately, my family were Italian, so we preserve everything. If you walk past, we'll preserve you and put you in a bottle. And so we would make tomato sauce and apricot jam and all sorts. And so I never got the opportunity to go and cash it in because my parents thought the Coke bottle was the best bottle to preserve in. Remember, Leo, we could put anything in that bottle. We could heat it up and it would go in the cellar and it would last for years. And so I never got my money back for those bottles. But what hit me over this excursion was that's what it is like for us sometimes. Sometimes it's in the heating process that we want to, before we get to the furnace, we want to jump out. We don't want to grow. We don't want to learn. We just want out. But it's in the heating process. It's in the furnace. It's in your darkest days, in your toughest times, when you call out to God that He does His best work. You see, that Coke bottle had an end, and that end was to be filled with a refreshing drink for people all over the world. Heard some South Africans tell me today they still, in Zimbabwe, they still have them. I know in Thailand they still have the old green bottles. You see, its end is to last. And sometimes we try and get out of something, but God is sometimes trying to teach us something. And in this day and age, time and time again, I'm meeting people who want to get out, want to be rescued like the Israelites were rescued. They had trust issues like we heard from Julie, and they want out. But, you know, sometimes when you're in a hard place, before you try and get out, ask God these questions. Is there something that I need to learn in this time? Is there something that I need to grow in? Teach me quickly. I'm ready to learn now. Is there something that I need, someone that I need to forgive? Is there something that I need, that the process, that the healing process and the furnace only refines me to be a stronger person? Whatever I face, I can walk through it stronger. We cannot skip the furnace times of life. God always uses those times. You won't be in the furnace a second longer that you need to be, and that is necessary, because at a point of time, you'll come out of it if you do it right. Listen to the great things that happened in the 70 years. We heard of the great things that God always intervened in. Then He had enough, and then He put them in exile for 70 years. But in the times of 70 years, and this is like, I think, their furnace times, and they responded well. And look what came out of 70 years of exile, 70 years of trouble, 70 years ago. And I don't like it here, but I'm going to get married and I'm going to have kids and I'm going to eat lots of food and I'm going to plant more trees. Listen to what happened. This is what happened. Number one, Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego were three of the captives that were taken into Babylon. They went on to become the best administrators of that country ever. Number two, Daniel was another one of the captives that was taken into Babylon. And Daniel, because of Daniel, was able to interpret the king's dreams, he was able to rule over the entire province of Babylon. So he became a ruler. Number three, with Daniel's help of the king, he becomes a believer of God. So the king becomes a believer of God through Daniel. He says in Daniel 4:37, he says, I, King Nebuchadnezzar, Nebi, praise and exalt and glorify the King of heaven, because everything he does is right and all his ways are just, and those who walk in pride, he is able to humble. So out of that, an exile in a place he didn't want to be, Daniel leads the king, Nebi, to the Lord. The beautiful moment in this king's life would never have happened if Daniel wasn't in a place of exile. Number four, because of the Jewish people, we were able to live in peace under the leadership of Daniel and the king. They had time to write some of the greatest books of the Bible. So in their exile, they wrote some of the greatest books of the Bible, and they were 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, and Psalm 137, all written in a place because they decided, I'm going to bloom where I planted. Because they decided, I'm going to forgive and I'm going to pray and I'm going to prosper. Because they decided, I'm going to hold on to the word of the Lord and see his promise come about. Number five, most important of all, during the 70 years of that period, the Jewish people were beginning to realize that they needed to get right with the Lord. Sometimes in our hard places, it might be something. And I don't believe all the time that these times are times that God creates. They're times because we've done some wrong decisions, or someone has decided to do something against us and we've carried that on. And in the 70 years, I like it, because what we see here is they began to see where they went wrong. They began to see the rebelliousness. They began to see this arrogance that they had. They began to acknowledge their mistakes. But not only did they begin to see, they began to repent. And they began to apologize. Jeremiah 4:18 says that your own conduct and actions have brought this upon you. How many times have you heard someone say, that's your fault? She left you because it's your fault. He left you because it's your fault. Kids don't listen to you because it's your fault, because you nag all the time. You got this sickness because you had unforgiveness. You got this because that happened. And so on and so on and so on. We've got to shut those voices, and we've got to bloom where we're planted. We've got to praise. We've got to pardon, and we've got to pray. And we've got to obey the word of God and his promises and hold on to those times. Number six is one of my favorites. I need Pastor Jonathan to come and help me with this. And number six, what happened in the 70 years is they wrote a song. And within minutes, it became number one's iTunes song. Some of you are going to remember it, because when a song becomes a number one hit, not that you were there in 597 BC, but when a song becomes a number one hit, we sing it sometimes years and years on. So Pastor Jonathan, would you come and join me? And the song is number one iTunes song in 597 BC is called By the Rivers of
Babylon. There we
Thank you, Steve. It's about the only time they'll get me to sing on stage is when I orchestrate it. So thank you, Pastor Jonathan, sang very well. And the song goes on, and when the wicked, and this is true, Psalm 137, you can read it. So the lyrics are in Psalm 137. Out of their brokenness, they sing a song. out of their hard place, they choose to sing a song. Sometimes in your darkest days, in your times where you feel choked, you can't breathe, sing a song. It's been in the times where my dark days, dark night of the soul, that I've written songs in my journal, or I've sung songs. No, I didn't get to write them because they wouldn't be published. But I sang songs. I made up my own songs. And it was in those times, in those dark times when I sang a song to the Lord that brought peace, that brought comfort, that brought me a sense of, I'm going to get through this because God is with me. For years, they were under oppression. For years, they were the chosen people in a place that they didn't want to be. They used to be guardians of the temple of the Lord, and now they were just fruit pickers. It weren't much. Jeremiah 7:3-4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I will let you live in this place. Do not trust in deceptive words and say, this is the temple of the Lord, this is the temple of the Lord, this is the temple of the Lord. Basically saying, don't believe the lies. Don't let the voice of the enemy say it's all over, it's final, this is your lot, this is what's going to happen. No, know that God is with you. Then know that in the valley he does his best work. In the furnaces he produces the best person. They didn't listen. And God used 70 years to cause them to come to their ways and know that God loved them so much. And he was going to come through and intervene, but he needed them to see some things first. You know, we look at the big picture, and you can see the hand of God working on them. They wrote books of the Bible. They sang by the rivers of Babylon. They learnt to praise. They got married. They learnt to flourish in the land that they didn't want to be. God's plan isn't always what we thought it was going to be, but God's plan is always the best plan. If you can remember that, God's plan is always the best plan. It may not be where you want to be, but choose to bloom. Choose to forgive, choose to pardon, choose to pray, choose to praise, choose to prosper, choose to hold on to God's word and his promises, and you'll come through. Even when we don't understand what's happening, even if we don't see the light at the end of the tunnel, even if we don't would have chosen this path for ourselves, but God is with us. And here comes the most favorite scripture, second most favorite scripture that we know, that we read today, that we misquote. The misquoted of this scripture is written in a place of heartache, in a place of hostility, in a place that they don't want to be. And the word of the Lord comes. The word of the Lord comes to Jeremiah, and this is what he says, Jeremiah 29:11-13, for I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. You think God has forgotten? No. I know he knows the plans that has for you, plans to prosper you and not to harm you. You think you're getting harmed? No, it's not God's way. Plans to give you a hope and a future. You may feel, I'm never going to be happy. I remember being in a time in my life and I thought, I'm never going to be happy again. I'm never going to love. I remember saying that to Mark. I was in a dark place, pretty much my own doing of choice, but I was in this dark place. I let my mind get into a place that it should never have gone. I listened to the lies of the enemy. I found myself believing the lies. I found myself believing what God, the opposite of what God was telling me and had said to me. And I remember being in this place and a shell of a person where I was a faith-filled person, I became a shell of a person. I remember saying, Mark, I don't think I'll ever, ever be happy again. I get emotional because I remember saying, I remember being in that place. I've come through it very well. But I remember, and he looked at me, yes, you will, because God gave you a promise and he gave you a word, and he just sort of gave me this. and it was. And I said, no, I'm not. I fought it. But then I went into the court of the Lord and I began to praise and I began to hold on. I began to declare the promise that God gave me 4 years before. See, God knew that I was going to get to this place because God knows all things. And out of my disobedience, pretty much it was my exile because of disobedience got me there. I can't say it was anyone else's fault, it's me. I know it's hard to believe I'm ever rebellious, but I was. That Coke can, it was a bit thinner back then, that Coke bottle was in the furnace. And when I came out, God was able to pour refreshing spiritual rivers of living water that today still flow out of me. But it was the furnace was horrible. It was test terrible. But in that, I chose to make a decision that I would bloom where I was planted, that I would forgive because some of it was I needed to forgive, that I would pray, that I would hold on to the promises of God. I come through that. I'd like the musicians to come. I want to tell you a great Jeremiah 30:30, God says, the days are coming when I will bring my people, Israel and Judah, back from captivity and restore them to the land that I have given to their forefathers to possess, says the Lord. So he's saying, I'm going to take you back. Time's up. I'm going to take you back. To them, it was the promised land. To us, it's our promised land. 70 years later, the Medes and the Persians conquered the kingdom of Babylon, and the Jews were allowed to go back home because the word of the Lord always comes true. 630 years after this event, God established a new covenant, and he sent his son Jesus Christ to die for all humanity, that those who choose to receive him will have eternal life. And today, we know that we have a Saviour, Jesus Christ, has paid the price for us. We can hold on to hope and a future because we hold on to God. Important lessons that we can learn from this is that he has a plan and a purpose and he wants to prosper. He has a hope and a future for our life. If you're in the furnace right now, ask God, not how can I get out, what do I need to learn, God? I'm ready to learn. Hold on. Bloom. Get out of bed. Brush your teeth. Get dressed. Have a shower first. Get dressed. Move on. Okay, God, who can I bless today? Hold on to the promises of God. Psalm 46:1. God is our refuge and strength, always ready to help in times of trouble. Today, I want every eye closed and every head bowed as we come to a close. Perhaps you're in a place, you don't know God, and you want to invite this gracious God that I was talking to you about. You want to invite Jesus Christ, how God sent his son to die on the cross for you and I. If that's you this morning, I want you to raise your hand as I just look over quickly. I want to pray for you. Is there anyone here? You want to connect to God? Perhaps you're here and you are in the furnace. You're in the dark place. You're in a place that you've never imagined to be in. Your heart is broken. You're going, what is the future? What is going on? If that's you this morning, I'm not going to get you to stand, but I do want you to raise your hand because I want to pray for you. I know there's many hands in the first service. If that's you this morning, I want to pray for you. I just want you to raise your hands, like acknowledge you, thank you. Thank you for your hands, right? Just keep them up because I want to pray for you right now. Father, I pray right now different ones, you see God, you know what is going on, you know the condition of their hearts, you know what is going on, Father, in their lives. But I pray that today, today's word of God, may it resonate, may they pick up their song, begin to sing. Father, may they begin to trust you again. And even for some, they have been trusting you. But Father, perhaps they haven't got a word of promise. Give them that word, I pray, that as they come into that quiet place with you. And Father, I pray for those that even don't know what is ahead in their future. Father, I pray, give them a short snippet of a vision. Give them a short snippet of the things that you have for them. Lord, and I pray that you would help these ones to learn how to sing a new song and rejoice. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We have Julie who's going to come, beautiful Julie, and do the announcements.
Can we thank Pastor Nina? That was That was exceptional. Amazing. Second time I've heard that, and I heard lots of new stuff second time around. So thank you, Pastor Nina. Just amazing.